Hello, today we are going to discuss about becoming an effective elementary teacher. Although it is almost impossible to define an effective teacher, but we will discuss some of the points, some of the issues that go on to make an effective teacher, as it has been observed by experts and responded by learners. What will be the most important condition of becoming or calling somebody an effective teacher? That would be, an effective teacher would be one who is able to augment learning in his or her students. What is the final outcome of our teaching? The final outcome must be that our learners are able to learn more through our help, our interaction, that is classroom interaction. So an effective teacher would be one who helps learners learn more and faster. So a teacher at elementary level, at secondary level, at senior secondary level or higher education level would have different methods and qualities to augment learning. We cannot have the identical or same qualities of a teacher who is teaching to a 6-year-old, that is class 1, or to an 18-year-old at the college level, because at every level the child is different and the methods of imparting learning or imparting the content would be different, because one, every child at every stage transforms. So the same child who had different methods of accepting or hearing a lecture or interacting with teacher in the classroom at 6-year-old, or when the same child goes on to secondary or senior secondary at the age of 14 or 16, will have entirely different acumen and methods of reacting. So the same strategies that we adopt for teaching to class 1 and which would be considered to be effective, to be efficient, will not be the same for teaching to class 5 learner, because the learner would be about 11-year-old and he or she would react differently to what we do. Say, for a 6-year-old who has come out of the family for the first time and missing his parents, your strategy for teaching would be different. You will perhaps have to replace a mother or parents and behave like a mother in the classroom. But as the child grows and goes on to class 5, the strategy would be different. So the strategy of teaching will have to change from class to class, from age group to age group. Continuously refine your classroom process and method of teaching. No strategy is final. We continuously need to evolve. What does that mean? That means that before going to a class, you have to know who your learners are, what is their age group, from which background they come, what type of families do they come from. You cannot have the same strategy in different schools. The clientele, the learners in one school may come from one background and they would expect a different method of approaching them. Say, to explain this, if you are teaching in a rural setup and your children come from families which are first generation learners, the parents are not educated, they have never been to school, so your strategy will have to be different. But if you are teaching to a class where your students come from families which are second or third generation learners, they are already exposed to content, they know a lot of things, you will have to have a different strategy to approach and to negotiate the content. They will not expect you to explain everything in greater detail. But if the children come from families which are first generation and they have no input from families, their parents are not able to help them, you will have to have a different strategy. Let me elaborate on this. If your children come from a family where there has not been a culture of education, perhaps you will need to tell them the importance of reading, writing and education. Whereas if children come from families where they have already educated parents, they have been to college or they are educated, they would already have counseled their children about the importance of education. So let me go back to the initial question, who is an effective teacher? If your children of class 1, go back home and tell their parents what they have learned. They are able to speak a few correct sentences. They are able to tell their parents what they have learned. Their parents will get encouraged and send them to school. But if you are talking at a level which is not befitting them, they may not learn. They may not get encouraged to remain in class. So you have to decide through your interaction with the learners what you are going to teach and how you are going to teach. Every child, every day is a new child. The parents might have scolded the child before coming to school. The child was feeling lethargic while coming to school. And he or she has been pushed to the school. Now it is your responsibility. Our job is very difficult. We are mother or father or parents to large number of children in the class. The expectation from us is huge. Parents at home manage 1, 2 or 3 children, but we in the classroom manage large number of children and children from different backgrounds, different mental setup, and every day they come with different baggage to the classroom. One child might have been pampered, another might have attended a party and slept late, one might have been scolded, the third may have gone on a trip and is tired. How do you adopt one strategy to teach all of them? And that is the challenge to you, to us, when we go to a class. I am especially referring to young children, 6 to 14 year, and that is our job, elementary teacher. So, what do we do? How do we manage this class? I will say, first assess yourself. We must continuously assess ourselves and we are the best judge. Ask yourself the question after every class, have I been effective today? Could I transact the curriculum, the content that I had decided to transact today and have been able to affect the learning that I wanted to do today? Ask yourself this question every day after every class and continuously assess yourself so that you are able to improve in the next class. Sometimes we are not very good judge of ourselves. We don't try to put critical questions to ourselves. These days, mobiles are available and you can record your lectures. Record a lecture. Ask your friend to record when you are lecturing. Look at the video after your class. Ask your peer group, ask your fellow teacher to assess your lecture and ask for comments. You know, our colleagues are the best judge. They are able to tell us, see, you didn't do this or you should have done this. So, through feedback from your peer group, your fellow teachers, you can improve your lectures. You can improve your performance. Because they also know how to handle children. They have also adopted certain techniques, certain methods, which they can contribute. And together, as a peer group, we can improve all of us. So, one is record your lectures, show it to your peer group, to your fellow teachers and ask for comments. Based on these comments and based on your own performance, prepare your lecture. Every class is a new class. So don't think that because you could lecture very well in the previous classes, you can go in the class and perform. We often make the mistake of believing that young children don't realize how we are teaching. We believe only higher education children or grown-up children are able to assess us. No, that's not correct. Young children know how we are teaching, and ask them or ask somebody else to ask for you, how was your teacher today? And you will get the feedback. Very young children are very critical. They know. And after every class, they would be able to tell you how did you perform, whether they enjoyed or not, and they learnt or not. Ask someone to assess them. Ask someone to go and ask them, what did you learn today? How was your teacher? Did you like your teacher? Did she deliver all that you wanted and you have learnt? So, okay, today you learnt about this. Tell me what have you learnt? And you will find out whether they have learnt or not. This process should be a continuous process. Do it yourself. Ask your colleagues to do it for you and tell you how did you perform. Another very good method is of asking the parents. Parents are one who are most interested in their own children. So every day when the child goes, either the mother or the father or somebody in the family would ask the child, what did you learn today? This is a question which all of us ask to all our children. So they know how their children are learning and how did the teachers perform. When you have a parent-teacher meeting, ask parents, what does your child say about my teaching? Is your child happy or not? They are your mirror. Ask them so that you can see your face on it. Don't get upset if they tell you things which you don't like. And don't punish the child after you have heard what their parents say. I'll give you a very good example. There was a child who met a counselor. And the counselor asked him, how is your teacher? The child said, oh, she is very strict. She doesn't like us to shout in the class. She doesn't like us to talk in the class. So when we talk, she is very angry and she also punishes us. We are asked to stand outside the class. The counselor, like a good counselor, told him, oh, your teacher beats you? She slaps you? That's not done. Go tell your teacher, next time she slaps you, she can lose her job. The child, like a slave, went and told the teacher, ma'am, if you beat us, if you slap us, your job can go, you will be dismissed. The teacher was very upset. And she started ignoring that child. When the parent-teacher meeting took place, the teacher told the parents, your child is very indisciplined. He tells me, if you beat me, your job can go, you can be thrown out of your job. The parents were very upset because parent knew that the counselor had told him. Now, what do the parents do? And the child was not really responsible. He was not guilty. As a good teacher, the teacher should have just taken this comment and thought, how is this child saying this? Who gave this idea to the child? But the teacher will be a good teacher if he or she doesn't react to this and tries to understand from where did this child get this idea and improve oneself. What happens when the child says something to us, we are affected by such comments. And then we start reacting to that child, either ignoring or pampering. Both are bad. We should neither pamper a child in the class nor punish a child in the class for our own understanding, our own feelings. We have to be very, very neutral. And most of the times, we are neutral as teachers, as good teachers, because we know they are like our children. If my son tells me something which is not pleasing, what do I do? Do I throw him off the house? No. I try to console the child, I try to explain to my son or my child, and then improve him or her. Be same. Explain to your children, explain to your students what is good, what is not good, how a child should behave, how a child should learn, and so that our children, all our children, continuously improve. A very important feature of assessing teachers is a student's performance. A student's performance in the class, at the examination, and also in the competitive exams. These are three different environments, and students perform differently in all three. A student may be very good in the classroom. If you ask a question, he or she would answer. But if you ask this child to write an exam in a formal situation, may not do very well, because mentally he or she is not prepared to write an examination in that mode. Sometimes children do very well in a school examination, but don't perform very well in competitive examinations. We know of children who do very well in a school exam, but in the competitive exam, they don't fare well, they don't get through. You have to prepare your child for all environment. So, if we know that our children have to perform in a national competition or a formal exam, take mock tests. Give them mock competitive exam in your classroom. Know your job and do it. In the sense that if you know my children have to perform in a competitive exam, how should I prepare them? And preparation makes perfect. If you give your children more examination, more mock tests, more slap tests, then they will do well. Prepare them for this. For this, also examine each child's background and accordingly plan the treatment. You cannot have the same treatment for all children all the time. One child may be good in one area, but may not be very good in another. So, you have to know about each child. Give time to your children. I know it's very difficult. Sometimes our classes are very big, large size class, and it's difficult to give time to each child. But then, be patient and hear your children. It may be a good strategy to sometimes just sit and hear your children. Just have an interaction classroom. Okay, this day, today, we are going to discuss about what we want to do. And see how children come out. They will tell you what they want, what they are enjoying, what they liked. This is reflecting on your teaching. What is important in children's life? The habit of learning. We have been saying spoon feeding is bad. But what do? We inculcate the habit of learning and learning to learn. Because the process of learning should not stop. If you work hard with your children and they perform well, good. But then what happens in life? Because you worked with them, you taught them so many things, they did well. But in life, they could not do well because you did not inculcate in them the habit of learning. So, don't just prepare your children to pass an exam or a competitive test. Inculcate the habit of learning continuously so that they succeed in life. What is our success? Our success is that our children who we teach are prepared for life and do well in life. How can you do it? Be liberal in praising your learners. Convey your disapprovals through your body language, and your approvals and disapprovals matter. In a classroom, you don't always need to scold children. Sometimes you can just give a smile and that will change the whole scenario. If a child gives good answer, just say that and it has done the wonder. Your child will know, other children would know that when you give a right answer, madam gives you a smile. That is the tact. Use all your body. Give them a signal that you have seen and the child has done well. And also, peer assessment is a good strategy. Plan and give peer assessment in class. Put 5 children in a group and ask them to assess each other. then ask them to give their assessment of other children. This works because they listen to your to their peer group. They listen to your through their friends. If a friend says you did well, they will be happy. And also use parents. Parents and managements are very important in improving students' performance and ultimately your effectiveness. Parents help us in achieving our goal but also make our job difficult. Manage parents, counsel them. What do I mean? Tell parents when they come what they should do, what they should not do. Parents transfer their burden to children. You have to become a scientist. You have to become a pilot. You have to become this. You have to become that. The children come to class believing they are going to become this. You have to tell them how they should behave in life, how they should just enjoy life and learn. Inform and educate your parents and your management. When you meet your parents in group and tell them how not to counsel their children. Educate your management. Your management will also always want that all your children should get 95% marks because they are interested in only showing that my children got good marks and high marks. That's not our job in the class. Our job in the class is to make good human beings a complete personality. A child who learns to live with others and be a good human being in society. That is our job. And this you will have to tell your parents, your management, this is my job and this is what we do. So in conclusion, what do we have to say? No one is born a good and effective teacher. We have to work and become an effective teacher. If we take good training, if we work on ourselves, if we work on our methods, we will become a good teacher. And continuously keep working on it. Your love and passion for the profession contributes. Be passionate. Be patient with your learners. See, it is often said that teaching is not our first choice and we have become teachers as our second or third choice. That's not true always. And even if that is true, let us now become a teacher. Be passionate about it. Be passionate about our learners. We live through our learners. When 20 years down the line, a learner comes and touches our feet and says, "Sir, you made my life. Wherever I have landed because of you." That changes lives. Every parent will have one or two or three children to tell them, "Parents, you did something for me." As teachers, hundreds and thousands of children come to us and tell us, "Teacher, it's because of you that I am here." That is teacher effectiveness. If students come back to you and tell you, "Sir, madam, you changed my life. Wherever I am because of you." That is our achievement and that is an effective teacher. So constantly update your skill, update your knowledge and keep working on it so that you know how times are changing and how you should change yourself. Read good literature. There are examples of good teachers and their experiments in the classroom. I can remember of one, Giju Bhai Vadeka. Read Divaswapn. Giju Bhai Vadeka was a lawyer from Gujarat and he became so passionate about teaching and children. He went to a school and taught children. He has done many experiments. I can narrate you these, but I won't. I would like you to read the book Divaswapn. Giju Bhai made many experiments. But unfortunately, we never remember Giju Bhai. Read Divaswapn and replicate some of these in your class. Don't lose touch with your learners. They are the best and ultimate judge of our effectiveness. Keep talking to them. Hear them. Listen to them. Ask them to tell you. They are so honest, they will tell you on your face. And as teachers, we should not get affected by adverse comments or their feedback. At the end, I will say, our job is very difficult, almost impossible. And effective teacher, the expression is almost an impossible term, but then if you are able to do it, don't forget, there is a massive reward for it because the satisfaction it gives to us when somebody comes and tells us, "You are my teacher," we work to become an effective teacher and through continuous progress, continuous working on it, we become effective teacher. I congratulate you on your decision to get trained as an elementary teacher and I hope some of the points that I have mentioned And one can mention many more points. These will contribute to becoming an effective teacher. All my best wishes, and I hope the points that I have raised, you will practice in your class, in your school, and also share with others how to become an effective teacher. Thank you very much.